407-709-0655 is number dial. You're tuned into the hottest station on the internet nation. It's your boy Izzy Stars LaVeja. Don't forget, you're tuned into the hottest station, ballroomsceneradio.com. Today I have Father John Kanzai Moschino.
Drums dig a little deeper, yeah. come over me. Deep in the jungle, then beat the drums. 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 Drums, 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 drums,
one thing before you walk out the door. You took my money. You took my heart, you took my love, you took my body. But when you touch my money, you took too much. Never will you grace these doors again. Get out. And take that dog with you. It's over for me. You want me to give you a ride? I'm sorry, there's something in the boot.
Father John Kenzai Moschino coming up soon at 10 o'clock. This is where Izzy Stars Love Asia on the ones and twos. And we're going to get it cracking. Don't forget the number 347-709-0655. Call us up. And we're about to get it live in just a minute. Don't forget, I have birthday shout outs coming up real quick.
Now I see the mother. My name is Maurice. I'm a transsexual from the lower side. I'm a third-sex person, which means I'm a woman living inside what used to be a man's body. I'm looking to find me a white nigga who has a lot of money, who's willing to pay for my tits, and who's not going to be judgmental about my feet. That is my feet. I'm a little self-conscious about my feet. Are you that white nigga?
Yeah, you look like a classy white nigga.
My name is Maurice.
That's it! I like that shit!
I need to find me a classy white nigga who's going to pay for my debt!
That the bar's under construction and shit. That's finished. It look finished. They don't got no linoleum up or nothing and shit. There's no rug down. They don't got no velvet and shit. Fake flowers. That shit's not done. But they make that shit look done. And the white niggas is there with greasy hair. And they got like this. No mother millers, let me tell you, alright?
You from Westchester? Holy shit! That's it! That's what I'm looking for, somebody from Westchester!
You don't hang out with any gorillas, do you? I'm sick of these motherfucking gorillas.
right, ladies and gentlemen, don't forget, we got the happy birthday shout. Birthday to Aline Gonzalez, Ninja, Shady Prada, Reno Wright Prestige, Vitality, Kimankno, Ninja, Beckham, Teclianti Milan, DJ David Taban, Maya, Ninja, Luna Lewis Khan. Richards, Vasquez, aka DJ Bola, Julia Lush, Rosa Coco, Ahmed Ninja, Buggy Block. Christina Richards, John Smith Moschino, Kansai Infinity. Tig Milan, Antoine Washington, Ebony, Paris Hilton, Ninja, Alor Infinity, DJ Spider, Pump the Beat, Arana Milan, Lanier, Miley Latex, Tanya Mizrahi, Bliss Ultra Omni, Dutch Mugler, Cash, Doll, Miyaki, Mugler, Pamela Wright, Tsunami, Damian Princess, Ebony, Lords, Frankie Ninja, Trigger Luciano Mizrahi, Ike, Champagne Infinity, Benny Ninja, Elizabeth Marie Ninja, that's my daughter, love you down, Cesar Valentino, RJ Extravaganza, all the way in Miami, Nuni La Beja, that's my house brother, Annie Milan, Jimmy Wong Extravaganza, Jessica Vanasia Ninja, Hakeem Shakur Infinity, my BFF. In the whole wide world, besides my female BFF, Tiberius Stretch Ninja, Chanel Lopez, Denise Infinity, Mother Denise Infinity, I see you, baby. Deja Vanita Khan, Barbara Her, legendary Barbara, iconic rights and activist Barbara Her, Verushka Bonici, Mantiga Revlon, Glinksy Igor, J. Lynn Levin, Xavier Extravaganza, Eccentrica, excuse me, Oliver Crooms, shout out to Striker Pose, by the way, Nagato B, Fuji Ninja, Mimi Ninja, Baron Milan, ooh, Grandma, Izzy Stars La Beja, that's me, Desiree La Beja, Jack Dorsho, Grimpy Ninja, Sean Darskin Jordan, Gigi Chanel, Percy Davis, Desiree Pandaris, Liana Jordan Richards, Alexis Lores, Niambi Prodigy. Shout out to my love MC Selvin, aka Meekly McDebra. Jose Manuel D. Extravaganza, my brother. Popeye Valenciaga, Candy X Levin, Bianca, Truman Ninja, Tommy Avant Garde, all the way in Chicago. Martina Precious. This is the snapback to the clapback.
To the hottest station on the internet nation, BallroomScenRadio.com.
my house, and in my house there is only... The one that can bring nations and nations of all jackals together under one house. You may be black, you may be white, you may be Jew or Gentile. It don't make a difference in our house. And this is Fresh.
Now the after hours start. Excuse me, who's the DJ? what? I feel some runway coming on right about now. These are the words, and this is the beat. These are the words, and this is the beat. These are the words, and this is the beat. These are the words, and this is the beat. These are the words, and this is the beat.
Omni. Are you ready for the Kiki?
Right, new music by Izzy Stars, La Beja, darling.
Not everybody here is house music. You know what I'm saying? Like Jackie Bobby, the originals. Jack, all night long.
Jack your body.
All right. What's up, John?
I'm here.
Father John, how are you?
Hey, how are you?
Oh, wow. Wow, we had a wonderful long year, didn't we? Thank you so much. I appreciate it. I'm excited and I'm honored to have you here on BallingStreamRadio.com.
Okay, hey, great. Great. Hello, everybody. Great to be here.
Work, work.
So where do we start?
Well, before we go into the interview, I wanted to do a quick moment of silence. Is that okay with you?
I'm having a problem with the connection.
Hello?
No, I feel like I can hear you.
Okay.
Say something.
All right, perfect. I want to do a moment of silence real quick. Give me a second. Let's have a moment of silence for Lex Miyagi Mugler, I'm sorry, Janet Planet Infinity, Chris Capone, Tiny Braxton LaBeja, Father Tiny Braxton LaBeja, Jason Brain Lick Tex, Maurice Mo Ebony, David Germana, a.k.a. DJ Justice. Let's have a quick moment of silence for these individuals. All right. Thank you so much. Are you there, Father?
I'm here. the connection.
Is it still a different?
Yes, I am here.
Okay, cool. All right, let's start off with where you're calling from.
Yo, is this connection, is that good?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yes.
What's going on. Can you hear me now?
Okay, yeah, I gotta put the speaker on so I can hear you. Yes, I am here.
We probably have a little latency going on tonight.
Where are you calling from?
This is bad connections.
Wow.
Can you hear me good?
Yeah, I can hear you good. You want to give me a call back?
Yes.
Let's go back into commercial break. We'll be right back. Are we there?
Yes.
All right, cool. Perfect. Where are you calling from?
Now you sound better.
I know, that's right. Where are you calling from, John?
Me, I'm from New Jersey.
I know, that's right. Shout out to New Jersey.
Yeah, Hackensack, New Jersey.
Shout out to New Jersey. You already know how it goes down. Shout out to the Jersey girls. Shout out to the New York girls. And
hey, New York, how you doing?
Yes. All right, let's get down to the nitty gritty.
How's everything tonight?
Tonight is going good, but some reason we were having a bad connection. So let's see what happens. You're still with me? Oh man.
Yes.
All right. Cool.
I'm here.
All right, cool. Let's talk about, you know, how was it for you, you know, back in the days when you were a youngster? How was it for you, you know, coming into the world? What was it for you being a child? How was it like?
When I was younger, that's when Christopher Street was very, very popping. And, you know, we had a lot of things to do. The New York City nightlife was very, very different than it is now, because like we always had somewhere to go. Like every day of the week, there was a club that we always frequented. You know what I'm saying? So like on Mondays, you went somewhere, and Tuesday, you went somewhere. And one of the first clubs that I started hanging out in was called Geeky Barnum Room, which I don't know if a lot of people know about, but that was the club that was in Midtown, and the name was Barnum because it was like a circus on the inside, you know, with trapeze acts, and they had a folly show, which was something like in the late 90s, early 2000s, how Escolita, I don't know if you ever saw how Escolita used to do their pageant show.
Yes.
They would have a thing called the fashion segment. And each girl would come out in an outfit, you know, whatever they chose. But it was always something that was very up to date and something that was in the magazines now. Like, if you open the magazines, like, these girls had it on. And I remember going there for the first time and, like, seeing something like that. And I was like, what? Because when I grew up, it was all about school. I wasn't allowed to go out. The only time that I was able to go out was like if I was doing sports or something like that. So like during my high school years, I had to take up sports because my mother was very into school and you had that good grades. And, you know, we didn't hang out or anything. So my first time actually going to Jesus is actually the first time I'd even been to a graduated. So, needless to say, I went there one night And I ended up going there every single night after that. And they actually ended up giving me a job there. And that's how, like, my nightlife started. Like, you know, like going there and being around people who, you know, who was like me. And being that I always liked the clothes and fashion ever since a little age. My mother always dressed me in, you know, very, 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 very nice outfits, which they were, you know. But I used to go to school in, like, shorts and bow ties and knickers and stuff like that. And I remember sometimes being ridiculed. And I remember telling myself when I was younger that, you know what, they can laugh now, but there's going to be a day when, like, no one is going to laugh at me. Like, I'm going to be, like, the it one, you know what I'm saying? Right. And that's almost all that started me getting into fashion, because when I was able to work and get my own money, I said I was going to be one of the people that they looked at that was very fashionable.
Wow. Amazing. Now, you started working at a young age then. You were inspired with work.
Yes, I actually, being that, I wanted to have things myself, I started, believe it or not, I started working in junior high school, like for very, like, about 12 or something. I used to go to supermarkets. Back then, they used to have supermarkets where the young kids could be at the end of the counters. And we would pack the bags for the, you know, the people, and then we would help them home, and they would tip us. And that's how I started making my, you know, my own money and for me, because I wanted to buy things. I wanted to have things. I wanted to look nice and whatever I wanted to buy. And even though my mother always bought, but, you know how you want to buy your own stuff. So, you know, I started doing that. And then I started doing, like, landscaping work, like gardening and stuff like that for different people. I always did something. Yeah, I always did something. And when I graduated, you know, I started, back then, they had agencies, like, on 14th Street and all around, where you could actually go and buy you a job. You know, you just have to have the money, and you would pay them, and they would give you a job. And that was, like, one of my first real jobs I actually paid for. I was a waiter at a restaurant that was on 34th and Park Avenue. Now, it's a school there now, but it used to be a restaurant there. And I remember working there. Like, I only used to work from, like, 10 to 2. But I used to make so much money that I didn't even need to take the train. I used to take the express bus to work for it. I was really, really making very good money. And I was able to buy whatever I wanted to buy, and I was always fashionable. And then, you know, hanging into a club like Gigi Barnum was, everybody went there, was dressed. And they had a bar that, when you, it was like two rooms, but they had a bar that was about a city block long, no lie. And every night when everybody came dressed up, they would always walk down the length of the bar because they always wanted people to, you know, everybody to see them, you know, what they had on or whatever. So that was a very, very and fashionable place. And that's how I really, really got into, like, fashion and stuff there. I actually met one of my good friends there, which was Crystal LaBeija, which was my very, very good friend. I actually ended up meeting her there.
Yes. That's history. And,
and, you know, and Crystal, let me just tell you, as far as how, like, you know, me really going to balls and stuff, you know, back then, it was... And she was in back then for the boosting, whatever. And she was in the boosting. And I used to go with her. And, you know, we used to get out, you know, whatever we wanted. We would go, we boosted. And like I said, I knew Crystal. And she's a very good friend of mine. And she taught me a lot on how, you know, how to present yourself, what, how you should be, you know. And she comes to me one day and she says, you know, you need to come to a ball. And like I said, this is my first time, like, being out, period. Because, you know, when I was, like I said, when I was in school, I was really allowed to go out. And I remember asking her, like, well, what is a ball? She says, you know, you get dressed up and you compete and this and that. And I saw something to the set like that in Gigi's, but they weren't on the scale that was like how Harlem was, but I didn't know that. I just knew like what it like kind of was about. And she told me, you know. And I remember going and seeing all these people, like nobody I knew, because I didn't know anybody, but the only one that I really knew was Crystal. And anybody from back then, or from clippings that you saw, Crystal used to have her own table at Balls. Like, she sat by herself, and she was like the... And, you know, make a long story short, you know, she took me, and I remember walking. I was at the end of the runway, and back then, like I said, since I was boosting and stuff, I used to wear, like, a lot of Kansai. And I remember I had on, like, all this Kansai, because I remember telling myself that I wanted to win, and I had on all this Kansai. So I get to the end of the runway, and I had on so much, I couldn't even, like, really move. So it was Pepper's ball. So Pepper looks at, you know, she looks down at the end of the runway. She sees me. She closes the category. So me not knowing anything, I was like, oh, well. So I go back. And, you know, of course, Crystal, she's carrying on her own table. She's doing her own thing. And I go back to Crystal, and I say, she goes, what happened? I said, they closed the category. She says, what? She said, oh, no, darling. And, she, you know, she gets up, and she walks up to Pepper, and she tells Pepper, my girlfriend wants to walk. And, you know, being... You know, Crystal, who she was, Pepper reopened the category. And I walked. Of course, I didn't win or anything. And, you know, the crowd kind of went out. So, you know, I was still, like, in awe of everything that was happening because it was my very first time walking. And you know, being a shit close to category, you know, like, and I didn't know much, but I knew that was shade. You know what I'm saying? I was like, oh, she's trying it. You know, not knowing who she was, I know who she was. I era part of my life with people doing that, because then, like, after that, I just, like, on a binge of, you know, everything I had to get was Kansai, you know. And, you know, some people think, people, that I actually gave myself that name. I didn't give myself that name. What happened, that name was given to me, Kansai John. I never said that's who I'm going to be. What had happened was, like, you know, being my name is so common, John, like, people would always ask about me, and they would be like, you know, like, have you seen John, or where's John, and you know, people would be like, John who? And it would be, you know, Kansai, you know, Kansai, and, you know, because I got to be, that's, like, all I wore, so that's how that name came into play, Kansai John.
Work. I live. I can't believe.
Yeah, so, You know, I had a, up in Elks Lodge, I had a very, very, very good career. Back then, what most people don't know, which is way different than it is today, in order for you to be legendary back then, you had to have two criteria. You had to win grand prize, because all these balls had different grand prizes. Everybody had a different grand prize. Was known for Kansai because that's what I was wearing. So I think Masuda or something like that.
Yes.
And being that they didn't per se ask for me, but if that's what you was known for, you expected to walk.
Right.
You suspect, I was expecting to see you because that's what, you know, that's you, you know. And that night, like I said, it didn't take me very long, believe it or not, because I don't know if people remember. Like I just said, man, my soul pepper, you're just going to tell you're going to wish. So that was my goal on making a name for myself in that scene at all costs. And, you know, of course, back then there were houses and stuff like that. And they told me that you have to be in a house. And I was like, no, I don't. I don't have to be in my house, in no house. A lot of people think that they get in a house and think that just because they're in the house carries them. It's not really supposed to be that way. It's supposed to be you. You're supposed to be the star and this and that. And I see...
Give a happy belated birthday to Crystal Gotti. My bad, we love you down. Don't forget. But back to John, real quick. Yes, it was a lot of work.
I mean, a little problem.
I'm sorry. There was a lot of work that you had to do to get a status.
Yes, you did.
You know, you had to have all
right,
the elements.
Yes.
You had to have the star, the statement, you know, the legend. And then the icon, you know what I mean? And you have to bring those elements in order to, you know, be legendary or icon.
Yeah. Well, you know what? Let me tell a lot of people this. You know, the balls nowadays have evolved into something different. But back in, because I started in 1979 in the earlys, balls was always about the fashion first. Always. It was always. It was not about Vogue. It was not about face. It was not about anything. It was always about fashion first. You know, we looked at it as being that we were, you know, back then everybody wasn't out of the closet so much as they are now. It was no, you know, like some of the terms that we have now, we didn't even have back then. Like, we didn't have transgender and things like that. Back then, you know, like, you know, just off the top of my head, just saying, you know, when I walked, you know, there was no house of Balenciaga. There wasn't an existence. There was no Prodigy. There was no Blahnik. There was, you know, I can go on and on and on of the houses that was not even in existence. It wasn't even there. So it's still, you know, people were still somewhat underground. And this was our way to... come be around people that were like us and to showcase ourselves. We used to call it like, this is our Academy Awards. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Everybody got dressed up. The judges was dressed up. If you was on that runway, you had to be dressed. You know what I'm saying? I actually remember seeing somebody get chopped on the runway, and they wasn't even walking a fashion category. They were walking Vogue, and they got chopped because their shoes was run over. And when they asked why, the announcer was, I think it was Jerry Dupree, was like, because this is a runway, and you do not come on a runway like this.
Right.
So, you know, like some of the things that you see now that, you know, that happens now and boom, it would never happen back then because they were not having that. They were not having it. This was the time to showcase yourself, and if you could not showcase yourself in a good way, then you got chopped. That was it. There was no ifs, ands, or buts about it because everybody understood that the level of competition was very high. And if you could not compete very high, then guess what? You did not compete. It was very that simple, you know. Like I said, I've been here. The only one who has been here really, you know, it's a couple, but like off my head is around the time was R.R. and Kevin Omni. And other than that, I'm before everybody else. I'm before them. Like I said, like we were talking earlier, if you're under 37 years old, guess what? When I was legendary, you wasn't even born.
Work.
So, you know, some people sometimes don't realize the accomplishments of people, you know, maybe because, you know, maybe you don't know me or you don't talk, but, you know, to be in the game for 37 years and to be one of the top players in your game for 37 years is not a feat that's easy to do. And it's probably not going to be duplicated.
Right.
In this day and age.
Okay.
It was a mistake. I had the wrong information. For some reason, I said birthday. It was supposed to be a moment of silence for Crystal LaBey, Crystal Gotti. And so later on in the show, we're going to give her our own personal moment of silence. So just please bear with us, okay? Let's talk about State to State, John.
Well, you know, me, back then, I haven't really... lately, with like since 2000, done a lot of state to state thing.
Right.
And like I said, because don't forget,
was it involved in the ballroom thing in the beginning? Was that important? Was that part of it though?
Well, you know what it was. My feeling was this: that you know, in order to make a big name for yourself, you had to do it in New York.
Right.
And like I said, I have been to other places. Like, I've been to Baltimore a couple of times. I recently went to Florida. I've been to Philly. But it was, you know, being in just one of the places that it originated from, you know, you always wanted to make, I myself always wanted to make sure that, that I did well in New York. Say if I wanted to go to someplace like Wisconsin, and you know, I was a legend in Wisconsin, would that still wouldn't hold the same weight as New York, because most people wouldn't even know who was in Wisconsin. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
But if I was from Wisconsin and I came to New York and I a good friend of mine, Albert Latex, who actually became the father of the House of Divisu.
Right.
And I used to go with him a lot, and I used to also go with Gerald Dupree. I don't know if most people might remember him, but that was a very, very good friend of mine. I mean, some of these people who are in the Hall of Fame or have made very, very good big names, so now most people don't know that these were really my good, good friends. And when I mean good friends, I don't mean friends like I saw you and I said hello. I mean like we hung out, like we were very, very close. You know, another one of my good friends was Hector, who actually started the House of Extravaganza. That was an extremely good friend of mine. And I actually remember on, you know, I think it was right after I had walked the ball in Harlem. And that night, I was crowned legendary because you know, I was wearing Cannon's Eye. And they had through all these, you know, I was wearing one collection. And they threw the previous collection off the balcony. And they were like, that was the night that it rained Cannon's Eye. And I remember the next day after, like I said, being the Village was always a focal point for mostly everybody. I was walking down Christopher Street, and I remember actually talking to him. He had saw that, and he said, you know what? You make me, I'm going to open a house
And I was like, you know, he was a good friend of mine. I was like, so go for it, girl. You know, what's it going to be? And I remember him telling me extravaganza. But, you know, like when people tell you things, you never, you know, you hear it, you know, okay, you know, you go for it. And, you know, I never thought it was going to be what it was. But shortly after it had actually opened, he actually passed away. They were Little Louie. They were all my very, very Carl, Coco. Like, you know, that's why these people have a special bond with them. I actually grew up. We all grew up together, you know. Even though there was way, way more of us, you know, that we thought that we were going to all, like, you know, live together, and, you know, we're all going to grow older, but a lot have passed away, Izzy. A lot have passed away. But I have seen you know, if you ever see me in a ball, I'm usually sitting in a corner somewhere. I'm just not one of those people to be around and be like, you know, it's over for me. And, you know, you got to see me. And I always thought that, you know, if you need to see me, you would see me when it counts most on the runway. And, you know, back in the day, you know, we didn't go through all this arguing and this and that. You know, you got a score to settle. I see you at the back of the runway. You know what I'm saying? And I think that would change a lot if, you know, people nowadays took that approach. You know what I'm saying? Why do I have to argue with you and this and that? That's why I'm not really into groups and all this and that. You know, if you have a problem, bring it to the runway. Yes. That's it.
Bring it
and settle it there, right? Why do you have to fight?
All right.
You know, so... You know, I see some of these things now, and, you know, some of it is disheartening to see. You know, I hear, you know, people claim things and do things and say all these things, and, you know, nobody's really here to dispute it, because if you wasn't here, how do you know?
Right, right.
But it's just one thing. I was here. I know who did what and what they did and what they were known for. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, it seems like a lot of people just get their life off of being false or fraud. And if it's nobody really to dispute it, what are you going to say, right?
Right, exactly. Yes. All right, give us a little bit about the elements of...
Oh, wow. Now I can hear you really good. Well, back in the day, like I said, ballroom has evolved so much that back in the day, it wasn't called labels. It was called models effect. And what that was is that you had to come out looking like a model. Exactly what the word was, models effect. That's how you were supposed to come out.
Right.
Issue. But back then, everybody was considered, you had to come out looking like a model. And, you know, the people that I mostly battled back then was C-Hack, Kevin Searcy, and Linwood Dupree. We were the four major people. Now, I know people come and they talk about other people, like, you know, Chrissy Montana and this and that. But you must understand, this was all after 86. So they were not some of these other people who you might know for walking labels, as we say it now. They were not there up to that time. Mostly, the big boom came with, you know, people doing all kind of crap and this and that, and after 86, and that's why it was so many people. But back then, it was usually us four. Us four is the ones that battled each other. And, you know, and at that time, you know, we were, and part of this is carried over now into how I am now. You know, when we walked, you didn't see people with the same things that other people had. The whole trick was, you know, and a lot of old girls are like that. We didn't want anything that anybody else had. You understand what I'm saying? Like, you know, you might have a couple of pieces here and there, but the majority, and being, like I said, back then, you know, we were all boosting and doing all kind of different things, you know, but, like, if we saw you in something that was in a magazine and you got it before us, guess what? The rest of us didn't get it because we didn't want it. You know, because it was hard to be different if everybody was walking around with the same thing. You understand what I'm saying? So that's why I chose Kansai at that time, because Kansai was one of the designers that was extremely hard to get. Now, you can get it, but you had to really be on top of your game to get it. Not everybody was wearing it, at least from 79 to 86. It really took off around 86, then that's when a lot of people were wearing it. But then at that time, that did, you know, some people who are out now, that, you know, people call legendary and this and that. What happened was the real players in the game was getting hot and they wasn't walking. And these people came and eked through the cracks. But guaranteed, when the real players came back to play again, they were a non-factor again.
Wow.
Right. So that's how back in the day, like you see how people everybody just gets crowned now, icon legend. That's how that happened. A lot, that's when crack had first hit the scenes and a lot of people had gotten into drugs and stuff. And they just wasn't walking. You know, people were doing other things, you know, having fun and getting high and stuff. And that's when it's a new wave of people come in. I guess that's when I'm from the white era. I guess that's when the red era all came through. And some of them was legitimate, but there was a lot that wasn't. There was a lot that might have had one small inkling of a moment, but not a big moment. Just a little moment. But, you know, they told all y'all people that we did this and we did that. But meanwhile, you know, like me and, you know, Kevin Searcy still here, we'd be like, you know, even when Portia, we'd be like, well, I don't really remember her for that, you know what I'm saying? But if that's how you get your life, you know, on lying or fooling people, then, you know, I'm like this, get your life, girl. You know, get your life. To me, that's not something that I chose to do. Like, you know, like I just told you now, I've had a bout with drugs. I'm not ashamed to tell anybody. You know, if most people talk to me, yeah, I tell, yeah, I had a bout with drugs. Yes, I was cracked out. Like a lot of people were back then at that time. Yes, I was. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but I think everybody was on drugs at some point in their life because, you know, after the 70s, it became a popular thing. I mean, people are still doing it now.
Yes. And, you know, when one of the reasons, too, you know, is, and let me tell everybody, people always want it. I know this is a question that probably is, like, on everybody's mind. Like, why does he still walk? Because, you know, just so most people don't know, I was actually put in the Hall of Fame in 2001.
Yes.
real quick, so you know, yes, I've been arrested. Yes, I have. Multiple times. Do I have a record? Yes, I do. Was I a drug addict? Yes, I was. Did I, when I stopped doing drugs, was the only thing that I had in my house was a bed and no sheets? Yes, it was. I walk to show people that, because see, ballroom and society in general will tell you what you can do and what you can't do. And you have to find it in yourself to say, no. Nobody is going to control my life but me. I choose which road I go down or which destiny. I still walk to show people that know me, and not everybody knows this, that no, you do not have to steal to be at a high level. No, you don't. You have to steal. You can have a record. You can still get a job. You understand what I'm saying? I don't have a glamorous job. No, I don't work on Fifth Avenue, people. I don't do hair. I don't do all this. I do that. I drive a bus. Okay? Anybody who's listening to this broadcast can drive a bus. Anybody can. So I'm not doing anything special. Nothing at all. I do it to show people that, you know what, you could still be something, but you have to work.
Right.
That's the bottom line. You have to work. Don't let people tell you that you have to steal or do things to be something. That's not true.
Right.
Because I'm not doing it. Did I do that before? But, you know, it's been like over 30 years since I actually took something. And look how I was able to turn my life around. You know, from a record,
yes,
being cracked out,
yes,
and all these things. Look at everything I've been able to accomplish.
God is good.
And you know why? Because I didn't listen to people when they said, oh, you can't do this, or you can't do that. Like now, you know, people want to tell me that I should stop wearing Westwood. No, I don't think so. Because you know what? It's my hard-earned money. And I will put on my back what I want to put on my back. And when I'm finished with it, then I will put something else on. But I will not do it because the crowd, who's probably not even accomplished half of what I just told you, because let me tell you something. Not everybody can stop doing drugs. Not everybody.
Okay.
So when you have major okay? In your life, then you tell me what to do. When you're not there, you know, it's one of my favorite lines. Get there first. Of the year, twice this year, and have gotten it multiple times since. So who you are and true to your game. Don't let somebody tell you what you should do, what they think you should do, or how you should do it. You do it yourself. Because you know what? Just because it might not work for you doesn't mean it's going to work for me. Right?
Right. You're absolutely right.
And I think that... Say again?
You're absolutely right.
I said you're absolutely right.
Like, I can't, I'm at all.
You're absolutely right.
Yes. Right. And, you know, and these are some of the things that, you know, I try to, put into the Infinities now. And like I said, because Ross was a good friend of mine. Me, you know, like I said, even when I was drama Skino, you understand what I'm saying? That's another thing with people, for all the people out there who want to get plucked, or they get frustrated because I wear a lot of Vivian Westwood. Do your history, okay? If you did your history, how do you think I was called Kansai John? Because I wore one piece of Kansai? You think I got that name that way? No. I got that name because that's all I wore, okay? I got John Moschino because that's all I wore. So I'm doing the same thing that I've done my whole life. I've always done that. So anybody who knows me would be like, well, John usually picks one designer, and he wears. So why is it such a problem now that everybody... with Wesley, what's the problem? What, to be honest with you, is I really don't care. Okay. But I mean, like, to me, it's foolish.
Okay, it's you know what it is. The children spark everything.
Say it again.
You know the children that like to spark everything.
Well, yeah, they do. But like I said, that, it doesn't bother me because I really don't care. You know what I'm saying? Like on that level, I. To me, I know like this, for me, ballroom is nice, it's entertaining, I love to do it, but it's not my life, you know what I'm saying? I have other things that I do. So, like I was telling you earlier, I'm not part of these groups and stuff. So am I going to sit here, to me, and this is for me, people, I'm going to sit here and harp so much on something that is not going to really help me in the real world. I'm going to be in the real world. Right. And I think if most people looked at it like that, we would all have fun. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But some people make it their world. And when you make it their world, like when they don't win, they want to fight, they want to this, they want to that, you know what I'm saying? It's all just because that's your world. If you're doing something which is supposed to be for fun, why are we fighting? Why are we fighting? You know, back in the day, you know how it was? This is what happened. You didn't win. You know what you told yourself? Well, I got to bring it harder next time. That's what you say. And if you, like, say I walked against somebody and they beat me, you know what I did? I studied that person. Like, okay, well, what did they do? You know, case an example. Say, if I'm wearing Kansai, which was one of the biggest designers in the 70s, you could not come against me and wear a Armani Exchange. Because you would tell yourself, you know what, he's wearing Kansai. You know what, I got to wear a designer comparable to him. So, be it back then, if it would have been Christian Dior, or even Alexander McQueen was even around then. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, you knew that you either had to wear Issey Miyake, Yoji Yamamoto, because these were the designers that was back then that would pick Parachute, or somebody like that. You knew that because you knew what your rival was going to be doing. These kids nowadays, they don't do that. They don't do that. And they all have an advantage because they all know, well, this bitch is going to be in Vivian Westwood. You really know. You don't have to guess. What is he going to wear? What is he going to wear? You already know. So you have an advantage. You know what? They don't even know how to take, you know, advantage of the advantage. You know what I'm saying? Because they're so worried about me wearing it that they can't put their own shit together. You know what I'm saying? You have to study. You have to look. When you see me walk, I wear a complete ensemble. Most of the time you see me, bag, coat, hat, everything. You see what was underneath it. Okay, your coat aside, girl, but what's up underneath it? Ooh. Nowadays, they'll walk with the coat closed, never open it. You'll be like, okay, well, you got the coat, but what happened to the rest of the outfit?
Ooh.
It's you should be top. Women, are you kidding me?
Wow.
It's easy to get women stuff. It's hard to get men stuff. This is why they shouldn't be having men walking against women. It's crazy. Women get all this crazy stuff. It's hard to get men stuff. And there's certain things back in the day you had to have on. Come out, come back in back to the day, come out with a fabulous suit on and no shirt. And see what would happen to your ass. Where's your shirt? No shirt? No, girl, this is a runway. What are you doing? Now you do that. Yeah, now you do it, Izzy, and everybody's like, whoa, bitch. And you're like, but her outfit is not complete. Why are you going up for that? And you know what? When you let it come through, because you know what? Ballroom now is watered down.
Okay, it's watered down. Them budget cuts really fucked everything up.
All you got to do is say, I want a happy meal and a status. Then you get it. Are you kidding me? What is your body of work? They say that. Oh, your body of work. Your body of work. But, you know, people know. You look at some of these people who they've deemed, and you'd be like, really? Well, what does she do? I ain't seen her. You understand? But, you know, it's because who you know and this and that. Now, you have so many people that are icons, like people like me, you got to give them another name. Because you can't say I'm on the same level as somebody you just made them an icon 5 years ago. But meanwhile, I got 32 years on them.
Wow.
So now you want to call people pioneers. You see how you have to keep the, you know, there was no icons before. I don't know if anybody remembers. Back in the 90s, there was no such thing as an icon.
No, yeah, actually, a couple people came on the show, on the episodes, and said that. So you're not the only one.
Right, because you know what happened? They gave Legendary out like it was Fruit Punch. That had to invent something else.
I'm fucking done.
And you know, and that, and then you know, then they sit back, and then they wonder why. They wonder why. Do you understand what I'm saying? You know, one thing. Let me clear up this for people to know. When they say, "Oh, the old girls and this and that," no, you know what? A lot of old girls don't come out. It's because of the foolishness, not because they can't compete. Are you kidding me? It's ridiculous to even say such a thing. No, because of the foolishness that is allowed to go on in these categories. I mean, if you look at Best Dressed, sometimes it looks like you are watching American Horror Story. You'd be like, what the fuck do they got on? And you'd be like, where are you going in that? You know, it's either you got to look like sci-fi with a little bit of Battlestar Galactica. Come on, poor guy, where are you going? And you know what? You know where everybody goes? It's over. Come on, let's not get fashion confused with maybe. Maybe I'm stressing. Maybe be put in a runway show.
I know that's right.
Okay? Because when you see a runway show and no models coming down, you do not see them walking down the street like that. You do not.
Right.
This is, you're supposed to be showcasing what we could do. Anything that I have, oh, believe me, you'll see me in it again. And you'll see me out in it. Because that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to take your time. Take your time. Put your outfit together. That is not only for this. We're talking about some of these people who, you know, they make clothes and this and that, you know what I'm saying? You know, you make something that will complete, you know, the strings are hanging, hems are crooked. You know, you even have people now that duplicate what designers did. come on, that's bad. You understand what I'm saying? If you sew, by all means, why can't you create something yourself? Or why can't you get the idea from the designer, but then put your own twist to it? Why do you go and replicate exactly what's in the store? And you know what the bad part about it is? They think people don't know. Of course we know. Because I might not be your Facebook friend, but guess what? Somebody saw you off, and you know what? They posted up a picture of how it was supposed to look and what you had on. You might not be your friend, but that happens all the time. Yeah. And you know what you say to yourself? Is it that serious to do that? Is it that serious to have somebody make something and duplicate it as a label? Is it that serious to walk out and say, I have on such and such designer? Meanwhile, you know it's not even that designer that you have on. Is it that serious to sew a label in a garment? Really? Is that, it's that serious? Really? Wow. And you know why they get away with it? Wow. You know why they get away with it? Wow. Because people don't say nothing.
Wow.
That's why. They know. After every boy, you know what? Go on Facebook and look at all the people that will be like, oh, her hem was this. Oh, her dress was that. Oh, her dress was street fabric. Oh, she duplicated that. Oh, reality made it for them. Oh, this one made it for them. All this and all. Why you didn't say something? Why you let it go? Why you let it go? But then you have, right, you have all these keyboards. You said it right. But you know what? This is America. This is America. And you know what? Anybody can compete. Anybody. You don't need any special qualifications or anything. Anybody can get out there and compete. So why sit behind a keyboard and tell everybody what they should do, or this one's outfit wasn't correct, or this one was a fraud, or this one is that? And then when the latex ball comes, and they're calling the categories, it's crickets.
Okay.
And you'd be like, but wait a minute. We just had 50 Joan River fashion polices telling everybody what we should do, and now where they at? Where they at? You understand? That bothers me. You understand what I'm saying? It bothers, you know, most people might not even realize this. Up to like 2011, most of these major balls at that point, between labels, they were not having it anymore.
Wow. Really?
I got on YouTube. This is how I came back. I got on YouTube and saw what these people were doing. And I said, oh, hell no. You're not gonna disrespect my category like that. Fuck that shit. And that's why I came back and started coming back. Now, if you notice, a lot of balls within the last 4 years has had Butch Queen labels in it. Okay. And I know it's because I'm one of the people that was walking. That's why. So when people want to come and they want to talk about me and do something like that. Do something like that. Resurrect a category. Make sure they call it again because of what you're doing. I don't see many people doing that. But I'll be the first one that they want to say something about.
Wow.
The first one. And I'll be looking like, are you serious? You understand what I'm saying? You know how many scratch in the pans I've seen in 37 years? You know how many people I've seen turn it for 1 or 2 years?
Okay.
And then, you know, everybody's like, you know what they tell me? Oh, you better watch out for this one. I mean, how long do you want me to watch? Because I don't think she's going to be here for a very long time. So how long do you want me to watch?
Got him.
And you know what happens? They go. My whole career. Thank you. Crickets, exactly. My ballroom career was never interrupted by jail time, people. It might have been interrupted by drugs, but it's never. Yet an icon. Are you consistent with what you do? If you're consistent, oh yes, by all means. You know what I'm saying? One of the when you can ask anybody who sees me in the streets, I always have on something. Always. Same. That's where that term comes from. When you see me in a club, you'll see me with a piece. You see me with an ensemble. That's where that term comes from. Not I'm always done when a ball comes around. Ooh. No. That's not what that means. That means that you always look nice when the ball comes around. That's what that means. That doesn't mean you're always serving. Right. That's not what that means. So some of these terms, they have just taken and just blown out of proportion. You know what I'm saying? See, everybody wants to be Mr. and Mrs. Fashionista. Everybody wants to tell everybody what to do. Right,
yeah.
And then you look, and then you look, and you ask them, "Well, do you live by yourself?
Okay.
Do you drive?
Okay.
Do you have credit? Do you have these things? Uh-huh. You know, you're so fabulous. Do you have any of these things that people who are fashionista have? Really? You know what I mean? Like, it's ridiculous. Nobody wants to give props to anybody else." I see people all the time. If I see somebody on Facebook, you know what I say? Wow, you look nice, sister. You know what they say? Oh, my God. Coming from somebody like you. Coming from what? I see you, child. It's not all that. I see you. It's over for you. But they think I don't see other people. I don't like other people. Isn't that crazy? I don't like. You know what I'm saying? I was talking to somebody. I said, you know, I live for Cassandra. I live and breathe. Everybody's looking at me like she's broke. Okay, what does that mean? That I never watch Vogue? Of course I watch Vogue. I might not watch it for 2 hours, but I watch it. I know who I like. You know, when I see people that do things, you know what I'm saying? Another person, I love Dimitri Lanvin. I love to see his outfits. I love seeing him walk.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I'm respectful to everybody. I don't bother anybody. I don't get into what you should do and what you should and
negativity.
You know, in all my years, I've never had anything happen to me like what happened at the last Latex Ball.
Wow. That was amazing. A lot of stuff happened at that Latex Ball. It was a fight, you know what I mean? There was a shaboom kabang kabang between you and Stephanie 007. There was a lot of things that happened at that ball.
Yeah. And, I told you earlier, and, you know, we'll top on that because I understand some people wanted to understand that whole situation.
Right.
First off, that did not start that night. And anybody who knows me knows. I don't feel like that. I won't get into all the details, but it kind of like a little snide remarks. And you know me, I'm like this, you know, I respect, like if anybody watched that video, like you said, just because I respect what you do, does not mean I'm your fan. I'm not your fan. Do I respect what you do? By all means. Do I think you put on a good show? By all means. But I'm not your fan though, darling. Like I said, don't forget, I watched you grow up. So why would I be your fan? Right. Okay? What you're trying to do, I did before you even became somebody. So that was my stance on that. Now, if you see the video, you see what I say. Listen, you do you do me. Like, people act like I just came out and started attacking somebody. No, I didn't. I said, you do you, and I do me.
Right.
Now, if people watch the video very carefully, we wasn't even in the battle zone yet. People are coming out for their tens. What the hell are you going up for? Why? And somebody's coming out for their tens. Let me tell you something, people. If that had happened back in the day, and that would have been Pepper, what do you think would have happened to her? And she interrupted her when she was trying to get a 10. What do you think would have happened? Okay, so let's get that straight now, okay? I didn't disrespect anybody. I was disrespected. Now, am I supposed to stand there and just let you say whatever? No.
Right.
No.
You have the right to defend yourself.
Right. Now, to clarify something, when people were like, oh, you were talking about her, running out of her name. Let's say that. That's not what I said. What I said was I stated a fact. I stated history. That's what I said. I said, I remember when. I didn't come out and call you that name. I didn't come out and call you anything. I said, I remember when. Okay? That's history. That's a part of your life. You know what I'm saying? You mean to tell me something that happened, like if somebody told me, John, I remember when you got high. I'm going to be highly offended? No, that's a part of my life. Okay, yeah, it was. That's not who I am now.
Right.
Okay, that's a part of your life. You just live because you become something else. Just X out everything else that happened in your life before. You understand what I'm saying? So no, I did not call her out of her name. People get it right. What I said is I remember when. And meaning that I was here way before you. Okay? So I wouldn't care how much you wore in the last 6 years. I have a head start. Okay? And you have to do what I do in the amount of years I've done to come for me. That's my stance. That's for anybody. I wouldn't care if you're in ballroom 20 years, 37. Okay, get another 17, then you... to do... But you see how small-minded people are,
right.
And they don't catch with things that you do because they're so hot on something else. And you know, and those are all labeled, and I had all the receipts for them and all the show them. Yes, I shop all over. I wear Vivienne Westwood as my main because that's what I like. But can I get other things? Yes. If anybody's been paying attention, they would know. I just want. Want to do, you know, and then you want to come on post and talk about he got on Westwood again. Meanwhile, I'm like, you idiot, you didn't see all that other stuff I had on?
Okay.
That wasn't even Vivienne Westwood.
Okay.
Or you don't understand English.
And the P. Because
I speak loud, I speak well, you can hear me. So, you know, that whole thing, you know, tell me no, people, I did not get life. from that. No, I was not very happy with that. But again, you can't go around. That's part of the problem too. You can't go around disrespecting pioneers or people who have been here way before you just because you dress or you have something. That's not the platform that you do that on. You know, that is a big platform. We should not be up there fighting.
Right.
Are you kidding me?
God, no.
Like that? Right, that doesn't look good. You know, I'm not proud of it, but in the same token, I'm not going to let you do that to me. You know, so just let anybody want to know, no, you're not going to do that to me. No, get out of here. No. I've never done that to anybody, ever. Ever. You know how many people I see, and I'd be like, Zing, girl, you think I actually go and do all of that? No, I don't do all that. You think, you know, I see people's photos on Facebook. Do you think I actually go and be like, oh, Miss Things, you be, you know, these? No, girl. I mean, come on.
Okay,
you know, it's gotten a little bit young, crazy.
That's very young, you know what I mean? That's tired for us older ones, you know what I mean? That's for the young clique.
Right, and we're supposed to be setting an example.
Right.
And I think that's what kind of got lost. We are supposed to be as setting an example and showing people this is what we do, this is how we carry ourselves, you know what I'm saying? How you see me, that's how I live. You know, I live by myself.
And
you go to work.
That's how you keep it always serving. It's a full package, your image, your personality.
What exactly is everything is combined. But you know what too, and I wanna say this to people too, because you know, just to clear some things up as they come to my mind as we're talking. You know, some people always want to know, well, how does he get this? How does he do that? He has to be doing crap. No, I don't. What happens was, while everybody chose to do craft, you know what I chose to do? I chose to build credit. That's what I did.
Okay.
I didn't say anything when everybody was running around crafting silly ways of packages. I didn't say anything. You didn't hear me come out, oh, this, she crafted. Oh, why she crafted? I didn't say that. Because you know what? I saw 4 years ago, 4 years ago, going on five, what it means to have credit. I learned that lesson. I said, oh, I want to make sure that my career is very lengthy. And I said, what's going to be the best way to do that? Through craft or through credit?
Okay.
The best way is through credit.
Right.
Because you know why, people? You know why, people? I shop or ask anybody who knows me. I'm all over the place. I tell anybody, any sale, any website, I have no problem telling you. Because you know what? You're not going to rain on my parade. It doesn't make no difference. Get yours. Because I'm going to get mine. So trust me, I'm going to get mine. I'm not one of them people. You ask me, if you ask me something, I've told many people, you know, if I know it's something you like, a designer, I will call you and tell them, oh, they're having a sale here, or go to this website, or this and that. But I knew the value of credit. I knew. So when I see something, no, I don't have to have any money. I can have one Newport in my pocket. That's it. And I can still get it. Why? Because I have credit. So that's how I do everything. I have a job. And I have credit. And these are the values that we need to be teaching the youth. That. Because the way the world is going, and I'm quite sure you know because you're quite successful, you have to have credit in this world if you're really going to go somewhere.
Okay.
You have to.
Yes.
And we don't instill that in our youth. What we do is we tell them, get it the fast way. You know, don't work hard for it. Just get it the fast way. But you know, fast money goes fast. You have to work for what you want.
Right.
And I work for what I want. So no, people, I'm not going around crafting.
Fast money goes
fast. Don't get me wrong now. I'm no angel. If somebody comes, with a piece now, you know, when I want it, I'll do it, but I ain't taking that chance. No.
Okay,
so, no, I'm not crafting.
Braces on your ass and you locked.
Yeah, no, I'm not really feeling right. I'm a little bit too old for that now. And part of that, like I said, is because everybody wants to be status hungry. I never saw anything like this. I just be looking like everything has to be status. Like, you gotta be kidding me. You know, when you water stuff down, it doesn't have the same value. You understand what I'm saying? Look at how many people that's been on your show. And I'm not saying that they are not, but look at how many people you've been on that's been on your show. That is either legendary, icon, or something like that. You understand what I'm saying? Where is the separation if everybody is that? Right. Where is the separation? Where is the elitist? Where is the people who's the elite of this? Where is it? There's no separation because everybody is one now. We're going to do this, we're going to do that, this person's going to be on this panel, we're going to do... And some of the people that's on it are the people that are the problem. How are you going to fix it?
Right, right.
How are you going to fix it? You know, it makes no sense. You know what I'm saying? It makes no sense. Everybody, if everybody took the time is and worried about their own life, and what they should do, worry about building up their own house. And what I mean house, I mean a ballroom house, your own personal house, and stuff like that. They wouldn't have the time to worry about what somebody else is doing. They wouldn't have the time all day long to sit and try to tear somebody down and talk about somebody. Do I make posts and stuff like that? Yeah, I don't. I'll see something out of them. But you think I sit at my, you'll never see me make like 50 posts in a day. You know why? Because I'm working. So I have time to sit on Facebook all goddamn day, and I'll be looking at them like, you know what? If they took Facebook away, Izzy, you know what? The suicide rate would go up. Because these people would be so non-relevant. Facebook makes them. You know, you look. Every time they put on an outfit, every day, look what I got. Really? I mean, come on. You know, if you really are somebody, guess what? You know, you see people with these names, and they're telling you what they are. So-and-so of the year, so-and-so. Well, listen, if you was that sad, we would know you was of the year. You can have to tell us,
okay.
Right? You have to tell us.
Everyone should know already.
The fact that you have to tell us means that, oh, you must not really be doing it. Because you don't see me, John. See, look on my Facebook. You don't see me, John, Overall Father, Infinity of the Year 2016.
Yes.
That's my, you know what I'm saying? That's my name? Like, really? You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, my last name is my, you know, my house name. Like, I'd be like, well, when you go for a job, that's what you tell them? So, it's good for one thing. You know what it was good for? To tell you who you should be around.
Right.
Because you ever be on Facebook and, you know, somebody friends you, and you know what you do? You go and, you know, you see them as being courteous. Because we're supposed to, as humans, we're supposed to be courteous. You know, you like their pictures, this, that. But you ever notice they never like one of your pictures, ever. And not even have to be a picture. They don't even like a post. Anything. It doesn't have to be about you. It could be what's going on in the world or something. They never like anything. And you know what? I get life off of that. Because I'd be like, can't take. Because why would you friend somebody and you never like nothing that they put? Then why are you their friend?
Right.
Why are you your friend? Why? But then you know what happens? And this just happened to me like 2 weeks ago. With somebody who's on there. And I don't have a problem with them. I think they're all right. I've seen things that they do. I mean, you know, I used to comment. They stopped, so I stopped. Because I'm not running up nobody's ass. But, you know, Denise made a comment about me on Facebook. Now, all of a sudden, here comes this person. Well, you say John is this, but da 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 da. And I'm like, Well, wait a minute. You've never liked any picture, any post, or anything, but the minute somebody wants to give me credit for something, now here you come to downplay it. And those are the people that I stay away from. Because you don't think that I look and I see, like, you know, who likes, you know, I post things, I look and see who likes what. Because you know what that tells me? Those people are like-minded like me. And those are the people I need to be around. Right. Why should I be around a bunch of haters or somebody that doesn't like me? Why should I be around you? So Facebook is good for that. But all that fighting on Facebook and this and that, I think it's ridiculous. All these groups, it's just to bash people. And you know what? It starts too many fights. It starts too many fights. It starts too many fights outside of ballroom. But then when it comes time for the ball, like you would say, crickets.
Okay.
Where's everybody at? You know, where's everybody at?
Where they at?
It just makes... It makes no sense. It makes no sense to me. You know what I'm saying? So,
what about
you know, I try to stay out of that.
What about New York? You know, and, not giving enough recognition to the icons and legends from Chicago, Atlanta, Florida, Midwest, Southwest, West Coast, and Europe. I know that's another big.
Say that, yeah, you said legends from where?
I said, how about New York not giving enough recognition to the icons and legends from Chicago, Atlanta, Florida, Midwest, Southwest, and the West Coast and Europe? I said, how about New York not giving enough recognition to the icons and legends from Chicago, Atlanta, Florida, Midwest, Southwest, and Europe? Did we do that again?
You better move so I can hear you.
We're not going for it again.
You're
going
to kill me. Which mostly wanted to know. You know, mostly will always ask me, why did I join the House of Infinity? Because at that time, you know, John Moschino was really quite fine with what he was doing. I really didn't have to join the house. Like I said, a lot of people, I think a lot of people think is that I'm not friends with a lot of people. I'm actually good friends with a lot of people. And I, per se, was very, very good friends with Ross. And I remember Ross meeting Ross on the pier, and we were talking, and he was actually coming back. And he was gone for a minute, and he came back, and he was taking over Infinity. And, you know, when I first joined Infinity, everybody was like, why? You know, we don't see it. We don't this. We don't that. Why? You know, you were fine. And, you know, and you know, a lot of people were rebellious because, you know, they refused to call me Infinity. They were just, you're John Moschino. You know, you're John Moschino. First off, let me tell people this, and this might sound a little funny to you. In my whole ball, let's say since I came back in the 90s, okay, because I was an extravaganza,
right.
But Ross was the only person to ever ask me to join his house. He was the only person. Now, he always said, it's all for you, bitch. Yeah, you need to come over here. Nobody else asked me.
Wow.
At that point, when I was coming back as, you know, John Moschino and not reinvented my, you know, self into, you know, the transition from Kansai to Moschino, at that point, I was like, I wanted to make the name for myself. You know what I'm saying? I didn't want to be in a house where you know, the whole house got all the accolades. I wanted it all for myself. I was like, wait, I'm doing all the work. Why should I let somebody else get it? I didn't enjoy it at that time. So when I had actually done everything that I could do, because just for anybody to know, any award that they have given at the awards ball, I have won.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? That pertains to my category. So if it's legendary, I call whatever award there, I had won. I had won all of them for during the course of this time. There was nothing left for me to do. The only thing that I hadn't really done was join a house. And I said, well, you know what? I'm always thinking outside the box. You know, I want to shake it up. I want people to, you know, be like, wow. You know, like, and to me, that was going to be the gag. I just thought I was going to be like, you know, New York father or something. I'm a New York father because I really wasn't into all the titles that they have now. A lot of fab bitches hung out on 42nd Street for girls who don't know. So try to dismiss somebody because they hang out there means you don't know much. Because a lot of the fab girls always hung out around Midtown. And I was, you know, with Ross, and he had mentioned to me that he had wanted me to be, you know, overall and this and that. And I was like, no, you know, because at that time he had an overall. And I knew the amount of work that it would take. And me, I'm like free-spirited, you know what I'm saying? I like to be like, I'm going to walk. You know, I know how to get myself together. I don't need no help. I do whatever I need to do. I come late. Usually I'm sitting in my car. They call me. I come a couple of categories before. I walk and I leave. I would not be able to do that if I had, you know, a big, big title. So I didn't want to do it. To my, you know, astonishment, like Ross, you know, anybody know Ross did what Ross wanted to do, and Ross had actually made me the overall. And, you know, he said, because, you know, you have a little bit of weight, and your name carries, and, you know, weight, and, you know, you need to be there. And right before he passed, like a month or two, he was asking me certain things, and I used to always tell him, well, no, Ross, because, you know, Ross is a founding father of the day. I could never, you know, this show, his project. And I would always tell him, no, Ross, this is your show. You know, I'm just here to assist you because, you know, I want him to do everything. I mean, you know, this is, you know, you. You know, you're still active, you know. And I think that he must have known that he was going to not be here. Because, like, he used to always tell me, but John, you're going to be the one to, like, run everything. And I would be like, no, I'm going to help you. And then, like, right after that happened, he passed. And one of his dreams, in case people know, that he wanted to throw a 25th anniversary ball. And we were actually in the beginning stages of talking about it, doing it. So when he passed, that's how the ball a year ago came about, because that was Ross's dream. He wanted to do something. Yeah, it wasn't. But, you know, the people that was there had a very nice time. A lot of people thought that I had targeted everybody. No, I didn't, because I already knew that some people, to be honest with you, I didn't want there, because I didn't want the foolishness, I didn't want the fighting, I didn't want that. So I didn't target those people. I didn't. I knew what I was doing, and if you've ever watched any of the videos from that ball, people were saying it was this and it was that. No, it wasn't. We had over 400 people there. You know, I wasn't looking for, we even sold this ball so I could pay my rent for 6 months. I didn't do that. I threw a ball because that was somebody's dream. Okay, I threw the ball in 42nd Street. Like I said, whenever I do something, it's always a story has a meaning or something to it. I threw the ball, or well, not me, our house, to say that, threw the ball at 42nd because we knew that that's an area that he hung out in. We wanted it to be someplace nice. You understand what I'm saying? We, you know, we got tired of people always complaining how ballroom should be, but nobody goes and they try to change it. You understand what I'm saying? So do we have the same usual suspects for judges? No, we did not. Because you can't always be complaining that the judging is fucked up, but then nobody does anything to change the judges. I mean, if you take pictures of some of these balls, you would think it's the same ball. Because you'd be like, what ball is that? It's like it's the same judges. It's like, no, this is a ball that was a year later. I mean, there's so many other people that you can go to that I was choosing people who went to balls, but they didn't walk. You know, they have a view. They know what they like. We made our categories very simple so the judges wouldn't have a lot to ask for, because I think that that's terrible to ask people to do all this crazy stuff. You know what I'm saying? You must wear all white, and you must wear all car accessories, and you must do it. People go out and spend their money, and then you don't even have your category. You don't even have the category. Like, really? Come on, people spend money for that, you know? So we kept everything very, very simple. Yes, anybody who was here, if you watch the videos, go listen to me, watch the video, look at how many people walked those categories. It was those categories was like one or two people walking. But to hear the haters talk, it was said, no. See, those are the people that we didn't want there. We didn't want them there. You know, say, you know how much it costs to rent BB Kings? Okay, this is about $2,000, $3,000 rental. We spent money. You understand what I'm saying? People want to talk about, oh, they're doing this and doing that. You know what? Get the flyer again and look at how much cash we gave out. $6,800. Okay, so people saying that we didn't do. No, those. For what you just did, we knew, I knew that. So I said, I've been around. I might not say nothing. Oh, but believe me, I know. Believe me, I know. And I was like, I didn't want those people there. I wanted, this was a nice, you know, this was a nice venue. You understand what I'm saying? We held a ball on a Saturday night. Not daytime, not on Sunday, on a Saturday night at night. You know what I'm saying? But people want to come talk about us, and then I look and be like, but I haven't even seen your house throw a ball since Heck Was a Pop. And you want to talk about somebody else who did something. Okay? People complain about they don't have a nice space. We gave them a nice space to come to. Most of the categories was no less. I think it was maybe Bush Queen and Jack, and maybe something else. Most of the least we gave out was $250. And you know why? Because the small-minded people couldn't see what we were doing. Like, you know what? They want to make sure everybody gets something. Not just Stace, not just Vogue, and not just, you know, whatever else they have. Everybody category has something that you could walk. We didn't ask for a lot. We gave out real trophies. We didn't give out no little, you know, look. Go on the video, people. Look and see. Those were real trophies that back in the day. The grand prizes was bigger trophies. We did a lot of things that we tried to incorporate new stuff. You understand what I'm saying? People complain, but if you don't come with no new ideas, how are you going to change anything? You know what I'm saying? At our ball, we had it. You know, if you was Icon or Pioneer, you didn't come get no tens. For what? For me personally, I don't believe in that. You've earned the right to come and compete. Look, for you to get that title means you, well, you should have. Nowadays, we don't know, but you should have had somebody of work. Why do you have to come up in there and beg for a 10 for a judge? Why? And you did. You've done it all these years. Now, after you, when you went to the battle zone, we were not responsible for what happened. But we paid homage to you for keeping it alive for the people who's doing it now. We did that. You understand what I'm saying?
Okay.
We did. Who paved the way for? So that ball was very, very nice. Was there a problem with the tables? Yes. But that is the problem, Tim, because that was an establishment that sold food. And if anybody has any kind of inclination about business, it's a conflict of interest. But we had special permission that we could. But the person who gave the okay wasn't there. So we had to wait for them to find them. Do you understand what I'm saying? By the time he found them, that's when the people were coming in. And when they were coming in, we're trying to put stuff on the table. They don't know that we can put stuff. So being an excited, they're taking stuff off. And that's where the confusion came for that. But if you saw, it's not that we had nothing. You know, I'm not afraid to say we didn't want them there. We didn't. And we did five. The people that was there had a nice time. The establishment was very happy with us. They were like, oh, you know what? We couldn't believe you had that many people. First off, they told us. And they said, you know what? If you want to come back, you could come back. Because that's what we wanted to do. This was somebody's dream. This was somebody's legacy. You know, you honor somebody, you're supposed to honor them in the highest form. And we thought we did that. You know, like, you know, the House of Infinity's name was on the billboard on 42nd Street. But tell it to the haters, what do? We didn't do nothing.
I lived when I seen
you. You understand what I'm saying? We didn't do anything. You know, that's not true. We did a lot. You watched it. Even I was shocked when I. In a regular ball, they were judged fairly, and they came out, and they got their 10s. They might not have won, but at least they got to compete with a judge and stuff like that. And they, like, there was two incidences from the ball. I think if anybody was throwing a ball of that magnitude, and somebody told them, listen, somebody's going to be upset with you, with the judge, and there might be a slight problem with the table. I think anybody would sign up for that. That's the only problem that you have with the ball? That's it. Yes.
Wow.
They said we started so late. No, we did not start late. We started, it was like almost an hour late. That was it. If it wasn't for B.B. King, we would have started. Because we were ready. We was ready. Like I said, we had our money, we had everything. If you was there, fine. You completed. If you didn't, then these are the things that I'm saying that people need to do. But they don't want to do it. They don't want to change. Who knows? Maybe you'll win some money. These judges don't know you. You know, there were some people who were well-known that didn't get through. And in a regular ball, you know they wouldn't have.
Okay.
Why? Because who they were. These people didn't know these people. They didn't. I don't know them. I don't see it. And that's what the way it should be. But they don't want to change. They don't want to change. They want to keep everything the same. So the people who bashed the Infinity Ball, please. Y'all was not there, most of y'all, and if you want to say yes, anybody who was there, they were like, a hole in the wall in the basement is crowded down.
Okay.
And you'd be like, well, don't y'all want to come to a really nice place? Don't y'all want to come to something that's centrally located that you don't have to worry about? Oh, either if we worked on Saturday, we could still go. You know, it's not on a Sunday. It's, you know, do you think they actually thought about that? No, because you know why? The haters, as usual, always want to downplay what people do when they go on Facebook and talk.
Okay.
And those same people, you know what you say? You know what you say to yourself, Lucy? Well, when was the last time you said, even New York City, there's not a lot of houses going well. A lot of people are doing anniversary balls, and the latex and the awards.
Exactly.
And I'm not talking about the last 2 years. I'm talking about the last 5 years.
Right.
Balls for the staple ball. But you haven't seen many other people's balls. So why are people going around talking about other people's balls when y'all can't even get one?
Exactly.
Because to rent a space like BB King costs money. To give out $6,800 costs money. To buy real trophies costs money. To pay for a DJ costs money. Commentator, money. All that. So they want to talk about you and say this, but they're so sad. But when it comes time to put the money on the table, there's nothing on the table. So, you know, stuff like that, I have a problem with. I don't need to be around those people.
Right.
Because it'll cause an argument, and it will cause a fight. You know, so I've learned to remove myself. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, I go around, I see all these people, I'm this, I'm that. And you know what? I go to a lot of fabulous parties because I know a lot of fabulous people. And you know what? I never see one of them, Izzy. Never. Not one of them. And you meet all these fabulous people in Baltimore. Telling everybody they're so fabulous. And I have so much status. And I'm so much this. I'd be like, well, how come at the third parties, you are never there? I go to a party, trust me, I don't stand online.
Okay.
I walk to the front. And if you're with me, you come in with me. Okay, that's what I do. But you don't see them. And it's just mind-boggling to me. And then you see people like, this is what people look up to. What? I'm not going to look up to nobody else. Are you kidding me? You know what I'm saying? You have to be doing something with yourself. It has to be more than just a garment or status for me. Okay. That's where I'm at right now. And if you're not that, then you know, hey, you know what? More power to you. You know, you have that right. But you can't be around me. You can't be around me. We'll be, hey, how you doing? Well, stuff. You gotta keep it to the side.
Right.
Because I'm too old to be arguing, and you know, that's why you see I haven't really been to no ball. I'm too, it's so ridiculous for me to have to argue with somebody over stuff that I bought, like I said, I bought with my money. And you mean to tell me I got to argue with somebody over that? Really? Out of all the things that's going on in this world, and this, all the things that's going on with the president. With you. Because I choose to spend my money on Vivian Westwood. Is that not crazy?
Right. No.
and I work, and I don't work 8 hours. I don't work 8 hours. I don't never work 8 hours, ever. There's always 10 and more. And you mean to tell me everything that I did, and I can't spend my money the way I want to spend my money, really? And I got to argue with you. Do you know what that tells me? You need to fall back, John. You need to fall back.
Right, right.
Because you know what I told you? Remember what I told you before?
Right.
I've been here for... ...to sit and wait it out. Because right. Believe me, or you're going to be around screaming too much longer. Because I've seen it time and time again. Those that want to tell everybody what they should do and this and that, let me see in about another 3 years. You don't believe me? Watch, people. About another 3 years. Everybody who's screaming now that they're this and they're that, watch 3 years from now. And I guarantee you, the list will go down. The list will go down. And we'll be saying, what happened to so-and-so?
Okay.
I haven't seen them. I mean, another one bites the dust. As many have.
Yikes.
So, I think I covered just about everything, right?
Yes, we did. Yes, we did. We most definitely did.
Yeah, I try. You know, I just was trying to think of some of the things that people really was wondering and wanted to know and understand. And one other thing too. Let me just touch on too. You know, sometimes people see me and they'd be like, "He looks like he's unapproachable," or you know, "He doesn't like to talk to people." Or this and that. No, one thing people might be like, I've just never been in a space where I've actually met you. So I don't know you. You know, I don't know you. Shay, I don't go out. I don't get off on that. I don't want to be shady like some people. You know, that's what they're legendary for. Throwing shade. Please, that's to me, that's tired. I'm not about that. But one thing you have to understand here, if you have somebody who has been in the scene a very long time, they're not going to run up to everybody. Hey, how you doing? Because that's like, see me, and I have to run up and beg you to talk. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. And why am I going to do that? See me and be my friend, and I have, you know, 8,000 friends on Facebook and all that. No, I'm not doing that. But I'm doing it. I was here before a lot. Like I said, mostly everybody. So why should I have to run up? Now, if you want to say hello and be cordial, fine. But for me, which I see a lot of, you know, some people do, they run up to make sure that everybody likes them and this and that. Everybody doesn't have to like you in that scene. They don't have to like you. A lot of people don't like me. Does it affect what I do? No. Because I'm not around it. I don't care. You know, you can hate me from New York. I'm in Jersey. I don't give a fuck. You know what I'm saying? If you don't want to talk to me, you don't think that what I did is good, or you don't think I have any compliments, fine. That is your, you know, those are people's choices. You know, you have that choice. But it doesn't affect me because I'm over here. I'm over here. So you're hating over there, or you're going to talk about an affinity bull, which was not true. It really didn't have any bearings because it was all not true. And people knew. The real people knew. See, that's part of the problem. There are real people that know, Izzy. There's real people that know. Everybody's not dead. Everybody's not dead. There's real people that know. We know.
Okay.
It's just that people maybe don't want to speak out. Or maybe people don't want to change. You understand what I'm saying? You know, like I said, you might want to talk about the Infinity Ball, but we took our money. You take your money. and you go rent a space.
I can.
And have a fab time. Right? That's what you do, right? You take your money, and that's what you do. You're tired of
money.
Icons. Your own money. And you know what you call this?
I caught that.
You understand what I'm saying? Right? That's what you do. Right? Not somebody else's money. Not somebody else's.
No fundraisers.
You take yours. And then you know what? You do whatever you want to do. Why don't you throw something? Oh, no, girl. You throw the haters. They want to tell everybody what you do. And then you'd be like, girl, why don't you walk? Oh, no, girl, I don't walk no more because, I'm not really all into it. But you never do.
Okay.
That doesn't make sense. You're telling everybody what they should do, but you're not really into it. Oh, I don't really go to balls like that no more, or this is that. Oh, the ball was so tired. Ooh. Okay, well, throw one, girl.
Okay.
It's easy. Throw one. Go ahead. Let me see you craft the trophies. Let me see you craft the prize money. Let me see you craft the space. So you just want to bash everybody else for what you can't do. And that's what you see. Yes. And you ever notice the biggest critics are the ones who can't do it? You ever notice that? And take notes on what is that person doing? How are they able to do it so long? What are they doing? Instead of bashing them, because you can't.
Right.
You can't do it. Like, your career is long gone, and now you want to come
we're getting ready to get close to the end of this show, but I want you to finish that last statement before we go. Moschino Infinity, Father John Moschino, Father John Kanzai Moschino Infinity, don't you ever forget it. And it was an honor having you on the show.
Yes, thank you so much. I really appreciate being here, okay?
Right. Thank you so much. And I'm going to get up with you, though, because we definitely got to continue this, though.
Yes, you can call me anytime, okay?
Yeah, most definitely. I got you.
All right. Well, good night, people. Have a good night, everyone.
All right. She was actually a trans woman. She was murdered. She's one of my fellow colleagues from the ballroom scene, and we just wanted to have a quick moment of silence. So if you guys don't mind, let us do this real quick. Thank you so much. It was cute being positive. Wow. We learned a lot today. We have found some information. You know how John Esquino knew Crystal LaBeija. That was fabulous. You know, and a lot of the things he said was definitely on point. Don't you think? And you already know how it goes down here on BallroomSceneRadio.com. That was the snapback to your clapback. And I got more for you. Don't forget, we're going to be here every Thursday nights now. We're not doing Monday nights anymore because, you know, it's a little light clapbacks going on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. But I'm going to do Thursday now. So, you know, because that seems to be a little nice light where no other shows is on. So it's no shade unless you make it shade. It's your boy Izzy Stars LaBeija Harley. Because I know you can't say that live on air. That's not professional, right? But it's okay, though. Because we going to do this my way. And like John said, we going to tell nobody or let anybody tell us what to do. Have a good evening, ballroom ladies and ballroom cows and ballroom boys and all that. You're ready to huddle down. See you next week.
Sponsored by the House of Ninja, House of Blonic, House of Ultra Army, House of Extravaganza, House of Infinity, House of Milan, House of Latex, and of course, the one and only, the legendary House of Stars. Special thanks to Danny Stretch Ninja, DJ Frankie Paradise, Steve Gonzalez, DJ Chip Chop Ninja, legendary Jay Blonic, Icon Kevin Ultra Army, Icon Angel Infinity, Icon Baron Milan, legendary Mother Power Infinity, and of course, Icon Grandfather Hector Extravaganza. Tune in every week at 9 p.m. for the hottest station on the Internet Nation, BallroomSceneRadio.com.